rancher, the grazer, these folks have many, many challenges.
The hay, the equipment, the labor, I know every bit of it has tripled or more.
We were in very deep debt and getting deeper.
I just can't seem to keep ahead.
Something had to change.
I really found out how helpless you can be.
That's it. I said, I've had enough. I did not know what I was going to become, but I knew in spades what I was not going to do.
There had to be a better way. It was kind of like being in a deep fog where you want to move forward, but you can't see your way. And then one day I was introduced to a holistic approach to grazing management.
Every day is a new opportunity, and every day more ranchers and land managers are discovering a holistic approach to grazing. This process benefits not only ranchers, but the environment and the livestock as well. As a result, the social, ecological, and financial components of the whole operation become more sustainable far into the future. The foundation for their success comes from changing the way they make decisions and understanding how the ecosystem around them functions and what influences it. In part one, four ranch families share their insights into the process that got them to where they are today. Part 2 examines how theory was put into practice for a holistic approach to grazing management.
Farmers are in the energy business. And so my job is to take sunlight, which is free. I didn't have to fight a war for it. I didn't have to buy oil. Didn't have to refine it. And didn't have to bring it on the farm so much for that. And I use solar collectors, which are green leaves, and they're harvested with livestock. The livestock turn it into muscle, which then I turn into a product. And that's an efficient system. This is a century farm. My great-grandfather homesteaded here in 1909, so my children are the fifth generation on this same land. I began farming in basically 1986, which was the year I graduated from WSU with a degree in general agriculture, with the intention of coming back to the farm. Basically lived a commodity farming life up until about 1995, where I decided I was going to do things differently, and that's led to a whole new chapter in my life. My epiphany, it happened in the fall of 1994, I believe, in a field just east of here where I had was burning wheat stubble. And it was next to a field where I'd grown snap beans for a local cannery. And just doing the math on the whole thing of how they controlled everything in the contract, from the price to the timing of harvest to the grading of the beans, and the fact that I made no money from that whatsoever. I said, look, I can do nothing and make nothing. Why should I work very hard and make nothing? I guess holistic management, for me, comes from a philosophy of integration rather than segmentation. In the agricultural world today, everything is segmented and specialized. You have, for instance, a cow-calf producer, a backgrounder, a feedlot finisher, a packer, a distributor, a wholesaler, a retailer. And each, although in their specialized niche, is very good and efficient at what they do, the way we've approached business is that we put all of those things under one umbrella. Processing for us is a means to an end, not an end in and of itself. I never set out to become a butcher. But what I wanted to do was merchandise a retail product to the public rather than dump a commodity. Okay, then I'd get dump price. And there's only one way to do that, and that is to create a product. And if you're not going to have someone else do that for you, processing, then you need to do it yourself. I design, permitted, constructed, and operate a mobile slaughter establishment. And it's the largest mobile kill floor federally inspected anywheres. And we've processed over 1,530 head of livestock in the last 16 months in that thing, using it just one day a week, except for the last month where we've gone to 2 days a week. On the farm, holistic management might mean that following an organic wheat crop, the weeds and the straw that's left get put up, and then following that comes turnips, for instance, feeding some of this straw with the turnips so that you can benefit another part of the system on your farm. So livestock were an integral part of a holistic approach in the farms of my grandfather's and great-grandfather's day. And so the waste of the one would be the food of the other, and vice versa. So that it led to a whole new way of business and life and thinking and philosophies that underlined our current business model today.
To me, the land's very special. Holistic management has given me a chance to really come up with tools and a different way of making decisions. It gives me a way of looking at how to monitor things. It's much healthier for the animals. It's better for the land in that we're using the land in a different way. I mean, if it works for me and I don't know that much, and I've been able to see huge improvements in 3 years' time, it works. About 1991, I took a class of holistic management and heard how many people were starving in the world. And one of the things talked about was how the grain that goes into the livestock could be used for human food, and that the livestock should be going back out into the natural range and stuff. And I had learned that grass-fed was healthy, and so between holistic management and the things that was going on there, it gave me the courage to step out. And for the next 5 years, I learned a lot and had a chance to get out and meet and talk with a lot of different people. And then in January of 2005, I inherited some money, took a leap of, I guess you'd call it faith. I decided to move to the center of the state. I ended up buying this property that I'm on, the 19.8 acres.
Very many things better in life than being able to go out in the field and watching the cattle graze in a lush pasture. It brings a lot of joy to me to be able to go out and watch them and knowing that I am making a difference on the land. Matheson Farms is a cow-calf operation. It's been in the family for over 50 years. We sell both commercial and purebred breeding stock, club calves, and grass-finished beef. Some of our cow families date back clear to the 1960s and the 1970s. I've spent almost my entire life on the farm, except for the years when I was in college, so it's a pretty special place to me. Around 1995, things were very difficult. There seemed to be quite a negative view of agriculture and farmers and ranchers from the environmental community, from the government, and even the public in general. Farmers were pretty much a hated species. It seemed like that we were a problem species, but yet, on the other hand, people forget that we're the ones who feed the world. And so I was feeling a little bit down about being a farmer. I didn't even want to tell people sometimes that I was a farmer. Personally, we were in debt. We were in very deep debt and getting deeper. We had a lot of concern about that. We were working very hard and losing money. So we knew that something had to change. And then one day I was introduced to a holistic approach to grazing, to managing resources, and just managing life in general. And that gave me some hope.
What I'm finding is that the diversity and the complexity of this system always throws itself at you in such a way that you go, wow, another aha moment. And that's pretty magical.
Which I think is important because it keeps us humble.
Oh,
I've learned not to get cocky, not to feel like I've mastered anything, because the minute I do, I seem to get wonked and and put in my place and realize I virtually know nothing and I need to become better and more aware of what I do.
Yeah. Well, we essentially run a small, diverse retail nursery along with a small, diverse farm in which we grow several varieties of fruit. We also raise sheep. And for the meat, not much money left in the wool anymore, unfortunately. And we do it with a real integrated approach. We propagate everything that we sell right here on site. And it's all certified organic.
I ended up here by mistake. My in-laws bought the farm, and I was in college, and we came to take 1 year off of college for a farming experience, just as a one-year project. But I was 19, and we got the great idea to buy a flock of sheep while we were here, not really thinking ahead to the end of the year. And I blame it on the sheep that we are still here because the end of the year came, and what do you do with a flock of sheep? No one else wanted to buy them, so we stayed. And we still have sheep 35 years later.
And I didn't have any, you know, background really with animal science other than, you know, I had a little experience with cattle, but I was basically a fruit guy. So that's kind of what, that part of the farm kind of reflects my personality. Been having to learn a lot about, you know, sheep management has been a challenge. Colleen still takes the lead in that respect because she's got more experience with that original flock, of which, you know, we still have the genetics from a lot of that flock, so it's great. It's a good, round you out to think about the relationship of animals and living things.
Although quite diverse in size, product, environment, and type of enterprise, all these operations have this in common: the desire to improve the environment, the business, the product, and quality of life for the ranchers and their livestock. How they are achieving this is through the practice of holistic management.
Holistic management is a framework for making decisions that are socially, economically, and ecologically balanced and sound. It begins with developing a holistic goal based on the whole, in other words, all the things that we're managing. And using that holistic goal, we've got testing guidelines to help us make decisions that are going to lead us in the direction of where we want to be. We also use monitoring in holistic management, and monitoring helps us look for the earliest indicator that we may or may not be on the right path to the direction that we're headed. From there, we can either get back on path or replan as necessary so that we can move towards that holistic goal, that vision for our future. And that puts things in a little bit better perspective and helps me to prioritize things.
Holistic management to me means that I'm managing a whole that has many interrelated parts, and affecting one part affects other parts. So it's like, you know, throwing a pebble into a pond or something. It has ripple effects that can go well beyond the initial intent, which is to, you know, throw a rock at a certain target point. The livestock were an integral part of a holistic approach in the farms of my grandfather's and great-grandfather's day. And so the waste of the one would be the food of the other and vice versa. And it's the same in the way we've approached the business.
In other words, it helps managers manage for sustainability in farms, ranches, or whatever endeavor that they're engaged in.
That gives me a different perspective on all of nature, all of life, all of dealing with the Homo sapiens out there that are animals also. I liked Alan Savory's philosophy, where it's a holistic management. You're not just, whenever you're dealing with one thing, it affects another thing, and that affects another thing, and so a person really needs to sit back and look.
It has to do with much more than just working with systems, agricultural systems. To me, there's a political side of it, and economics, it deals with people. And so I've been really drawn to the people part of this too. And so I find that to feel really whole about what I'm doing in my life, I have this side of me that has to go that way and has to think about and engage in those things because they're a priority. I don't think that we as individuals, as human beings, can think about holism and basically hole up on a farm and accomplish what we need to accomplish in a society that is currently going through a lot of we're going through a state of flux. I mean, we've got a lot of things to be held accountable for. And so I think, you know, being actively involved in the circles of influence, not only with the natural growing of things, but with the natural evolution of human society and the way people think about life and about food and about our whole existence, really revolves around thinking about holism and thinking about holistic management.
By working with nature and mimicking natural systems, there are many benefits. The animals do the work. They fertilize, harvest, and condition the soil while improving the land and the ecosystem processes.
Well, the benefits of holistic planned grazing would be that one can actually enhance the ecosystem to actually improve the plant community, increase the production quite often, increase the carrying capacity for livestock, for grazing animals, and leading down the road to a more healthy ecosystem and greater profit.
I have been able to see drastic changes. I've been able to double in 3.5 years my clover patch. It's actually taking over some of the scab patches where there's a lot of rock and stuff. And I'm seeing that my water and moisture is going a lot further with that. Last year I had a problem with water sitting after only running for 12 hours on the ground. I had a lot of puddles and a lot of runoff. It wasn't going down into the ground. This year, I can let it sit for 2 days and go back out an hour later, and there's no puddles, no runoff. It's actually going down into the ground this year. So to me, I think that's telling me that I'm developing a root system. And I did someplace pull some weeds out in the field and ended up finding a couple angleworms, and that surprised me. Emotionally, I get quite attached and get this big boost of joy when I see that I have all kinds of different clovers and alfalfas and grasses taking over where the weeds were or there was bare ground. So that's been exciting. I get emotional about that.
Another benefit is that in an organic system, which is what I am, we don't use purchase fertilizers. In our area around here, that same nitrogen fertilizer tends to leach through the soil profile, particularly in the sandier areas out in the basin, and get into the groundwater. And so this causes high nitrates in the groundwater and blue babies and the like. Well, you don't have that when nitrogen is tied up in living things, in bacteria and in organic matter. These are really important. So there's huge environmental benefits from that standpoint. Another environmental benefit that comes along with managed grazing is the fact that I don't have animals in confinement. So I don't have the dust, odor issues of cattle laying in mountains of their own poop. They're out on grasslands finishing, which is a much better setting, both pictorially as well as environmentally. I basically did what my grandfather did. I just put the two back together again. In other words, we took all our livestock, we put them in feedlots and concentrated them there. We wonder why we have an environmental problem in our feedlot and why we have a fertility problem in our fields. Well, 4/5 of what goes in the front end of a cow goes out the bottom and the back. Let her spread her own wealth. And that's what we've done.
I mean, the level of health in those animals went skyrocketing. Fewer problems. That's been a really interesting and eye-opening experience for me.
As we go along, we keep incorporating this philosophy into how to mimic nature in the way, and respect the land and respect the cycles, because in my eyes, it's been perfectly worked out. And the less we mess with things and the more we mimic the way it's done in nature, the more successful we are. When we fight it, then we lose.
The more that we go into expensive oil and the cost of energy in corn, the more sunlight harvesting and natural systems like this can compete against these others. Another benefit that comes from managed grazing is carbon sequestration. Talking about climate change, you may call it global warming if you want. The point is, it's changing. And carbon is the fuel of the soil, just like carbon is the fuel in our bodies in terms of sugar, or in our cars in terms of gasoline. And without fuel in the soil, the soil's engine stalls or dies. You get much more carbon put back in the soil in terms of roots, in terms of earthworms and other small life in the soil, that you don't get when you farm all that life out of the soil. So we still use tillage and such, but we minimize it. It's only once every so many years, or when we do use tillage, it's minimal on the surface as opposed to deep plowing, for instance. So what happens when windstorms come along, for instance, or heavy rain events, there's no erosion on my farms. So the dust that's in the air from the dust storms doesn't come from my place. And the mud that runs off onto the county roads doesn't come from my place. So these are benefits.
Looking at the world through a holistic perspective has really opened my eyes a lot. I've been able to create a healthier ecosystem. I have a more complex and biodiverse plant community and community of living organisms, both on the ground and in the soil. So we're seeing greater forage production. The animals are healthier, the animals are happier. Taking the holistic approach to grazing management really has made all the difference.
In order to manage holistically, one must understand the environment and what influences it. In his observations over many years, Alan Savory, founder of the holistic management process, discovered 4 key insights. A holistic perspective is essential in management. Nature functions in wholes with complex relationships. Every component affects and is affected by the others around it. One cannot wholly understand one part unless it is explored in its natural environment. The brittleness scale is a representation of environments from high humidity and perennial rainfall to very arid seasonal rainfall areas. Each of these environments has a different kind of vegetation breakdown and responds differently to rest. In a relatively non-brittle environment, such as moist, lush regions, bacterial decomposition of vegetation occurs quickly, often before the next growing season occurs. Plant spacing is generally close, and rest results in overgrowth and succession toward brush and forest. In the more brittle areas, plant spacing is usually farther apart. Oxidation of plant material is slow, and it may take several years for old vegetation to break down. If the oxidized material is not grazed or disturbed, new growth within a perennial plant may be smothered out. In a natural system, predators stalk their prey, causing them to move quickly from one area to the next. Herbivores graze severely and impact soil with their hooves. This is a benefit to the land, particularly in more brittle areas. There is a myth that too many animals causes overgrazing. Rather, overgrazing of plants is actually a result of the amount of time that animals are present on a piece of land and not due to the number of animals. Concentrating a large number of animals on a small piece of land for a short duration will actually benefit that land.
We have four very important ecosystem processes that are taking place on the land in any ecosystem, and that's the water cycle, the mineral cycle, the community dynamics, and the solar energy flow. And so when we're monitoring, we're looking at things that give us clues as to the effectiveness of each one of those ecosystem processes.
How do you put this theory into practice? By mimicking nature in the best way you can.
Well, I guess I think of them as being kind of a yin-yang symbol. It's kind of like without...
The sheep.
Yeah, the sheep and the land.
Mm-hmm.
Without the sheep, the carbon cycle kind of slows down and basically gets to a very low level of efficiency. Whereas if I think about the sheep and as a management tool, it's kind of my organic lawnmowers. What they're taking and what they're leaving and... terms of nutrients and also in terms of animal impact and the response of the forages and the brush and I mean the whole environment on their actions. It's all part of a really important cycle that to me is really interesting to monitor and watch as the seasons go by.
Basic premises to model or to mimic nature's way of animals moving in herds for short durations, grazing, and then giving those forages a period of rest. And so we can do the same thing with domesticated livestock that would happen with wild animals, for instance, using electric fences, herding, and the like. And what you get when you have an appropriate rest period is increased productivity. It'd be the same thing if it was continuous grazing as keeping you up day in, day out for weeks on end. How productive would you be? But if you got a good night's sleep and you could come back and work the next day, I think you'd be more productive. And that's the same approach that we use to pasture management.
In terms of grazing management, we began by understanding a little bit more about the ecosystem. I learned that grass not only, you know, just needs sunlight and good soil and moisture to grow, but that it also needs to be harvested. And the harvesting will help, you know, take off that more mature growth and to deposit litter on the ground as well as feeding the animals. By allowing that grass to have a chance to recover and regrow, that I am able to produce greater production off of that land than just the traditional way of grazing, which was putting the animals in a large field, leaving them there for the summer, taking them back in the fall. The old traditional way was very tough on the ground. Many plants were overgrazed. The less palatable plants, the weeds, tended to not be eaten and therefore had a chance to reproduce, and the land and the plant communities began to degrade.
There are many things to consider when creating a grazing plan.
One must know the plant community that one is dealing with, and so that makes a difference. The amount of precipitation and temperature factors will all play into recovery time and those kinds of things. The grazer needs to keep in mind not only the amount of time that it'll take for the plants to recover, and that'll change with the season of the year, but also if there are other factors, for example, birds, certain seasons they'll be nesting, they'll want to avoid those nesting sites. In terms of big game animals, if there are does that are fawning, or elk cows that are calving. They'll want to stay away from those kinds of areas in that season. And so there are all a myriad of things that could be going on that need to be considered in developing that grazing plan. And working around those kinds of things, and all the while ensuring that one does not come back to paddock A until paddock A has had a chance to regrow from the last time it was grazed.
A planning calendar is a helpful tool in keeping all of these things in mind. Plotting important events such as breeding, birthing, nesting, haying, and even vacations, the grazier will be better prepared to create the grazing plan. The grazing plan considers the estimated forage, grazing periods, forage recovery, and stocking rates of the paddocks. It provides a record of actual paddock moves, degree of forage utilization, rainfall, and other observations. The plan changes with the growing season versus the non-growing season. The holistic approach to grazing is a relatively simple way to create a plan on paper with many complex variables and to record the actual events. In the absence of herding, creative fencing is another tool to achieve the benefits of holistic grazing.
Using the principles of holistic plan grazing, we began by actually looking at the ground, seeing what the plant communities were that were there, what was the land capable of, how many animals did we have, how much land did we have. I learned the concept that by concentrating a large number of animals on a small piece of ground, those animals could impact that ground to a greater degree. We're in a very moist, high rainfall area. We have a lot of moss, and that moss tends to form kind of a cap on the ground and keeps a lot of the grasses from growing. So those sharp hooves would go in the springtime and actually break up that moss to the point where then sunlight could reach those seeds, those seedlings, and allow those plants to grow. To do this, we actually began to put up some more fencing. We had barbed wire perimeter fences all around and maybe a couple of lines going through the property on the home farm. But we put up some permanent electric fencing and also some portable electric fencing, where we used portable posts and a reel with wire, and actually broke up those paddocks into smaller sections. So what I was able to do was to leave those animals in there oftentimes just for one day, sometimes maybe up to about 3 days. But by putting those animals in, they moved in that paddock. They more evenly took the grasses, taking not only the good grasses, the palatable grasses, but also the weeds and some of the less palatable grasses as well. They urinated, they put manure on the ground, they stepped in it and deposited that manure more evenly, thereby fertilizing the ground more naturally. And then I took them off before those plants had a chance to regrow. And so by doing that, then the animals would move to the next paddock, and it would be quite a while before they would come back again. Depending upon how fast the grasses were growing, they might not come back for a month. It might be 6 weeks or maybe a little bit longer. But I allowed those plants a chance to recover, and that made the big difference. Well, that's what my animals are doing. Every day, they have new pasture. They maintain a high plane of nutrition throughout the growing season.
So there was a history of, of a lot of, well, just turn them loose and let them do their thing. And about the same time that I got involved with holistic management and got a real interest in refencing the interior, and so it became this, I hate to say it, but to me it was like this living sculpture thing where, you create this arbitrary human construct that allows you to put the animals where you want them, to give the rest of the land a chance to harvest solar energy without a lot of undue influence from the animals. Otherwise, we started thinking about the concept of the salad bar. What can we give them today that they're going to really home in on and they're going to enjoy? And what can we give them tomorrow that they're also going to enjoy, as opposed to letting them have one area for 2 months straight, you know, set stocking. And unfortunately, there's a lot of that model out there still. And what I became enthralled with was, well, you know, what's the total number of days that I can get out of all this land? And so it became this project of you know, constantly evaluating where to place fences, you know, where it would allow the best movement possible. And then the interesting thing was that as I started, you know, looking at what was going on or monitoring what was happening, I realized that the land started going through some changes. They started noticing things that I had never noticed before because they never had the chance to express themselves, really. And that even holds true up in the orchard, is that, you know, I began to think about, well, here we're harvesting solar energy on the grass level of the sheep, and then we have this beautiful palmette espalier Asian pear going on this plane, which is harvesting solar energy that way. And then above that, we have the kiwi fruit. So here's this little tiny, you know, almost 1.5 acres, and it's harvesting all the solar energy to such a high degree that it's become this really interesting installation, really, you know, of a natural system, and it just the play that it generates off of itself. Let's put the context of this management of sheep in that time of year, June into July, when we're making the transition from really active grass growth to everything starting to slow down. Then it's kind of like I have to start, and we both actually have to start taking a more proactive approach to kind of looking ahead to where we're going. And with that slowdown, then the management is, well, okay, what parts of the farm and the paddocks do we want to put a little bit of extra nutrients on in terms of manures? What land can we afford to kind of say that, okay, this is the area we're going to really impact heavily with animal impact this year? Lots of manure, and we might later on in the season, as it really dries out, August into September, start bringing in some feed, and actually feed, as what I call feed and seed, where we actually help the sheep by bringing in feed, and we're also allowing all that manure to be deposited all over them. We're also bringing up the organic matter because of all this feed we're bringing in, and moving nutrients into that system. And so that's one of the things I think a lot about. And that and the day-to-day, you know, thing with maintenance of fences.
Many different kinds of fencing materials may be used effectively in a grazing plan. Barbed wire, woven wire, high tensile electric, electrified netting, semi-portable electric, and portable posts and reels may be used in any combination. Woody shrubs can sometimes take the place of fence posts. Power chargers may be electric, battery, or solar. The type or size of the fencing system depends on the species, the terrain, and the amount of land to be fenced. An appropriate, effectively designed and maintained electric fence system will keep the respect of the livestock and enhance the implementation of a holistic grazing plan.
What do I see in my future? More educating, more hands-on. I would like to get my customers or their children coming out to see different parts of the farm now that I'm getting it more functional, and explaining to them what it was, how it got where it is, and where I want to see it go in the future. It's gotten easier to deal with life. I have found through holistic management an approach that works, and it's given me hope, and in that I found pleasures and enjoyments that you just can't describe otherwise.
Yeah, I mean, I try to think back, if I hadn't stumbled upon any of this, where I'd be now. And I think about that, and I think there's like this void there, that's like this blackness that I can't go to, because it represents the way that, unfortunately, so many people have thought about their relationship with animals and the land in the past. And it's kind of really cool to be able to say, well, you know, here's what happened to me, now what happens to you and your relationship with your animals and your land. may be similar, but it may be entirely different. You may have results that will, you know, that you'll notice because you're starting to think differently about what you're doing and how you're doing it. And that's where it's at. As long as I'm breathing and walking, I keep doing it. I mean, and maybe, you know, that's, I guess I'm always hopeful that the circles of influence will, you know, move outward and, you know, and I think every year it does. It's pretty neat.
Mm-hmm. It's okay to think outside the box and to live what you believe and to realize that there are many ways to do things that are not conventional but work and actually may work better. We're beginning to raise our cows on grass like my grandmother did. We're beginning to take chickens out of the tiny little wire cages and let them run around like my grandmother did. Why not also grow plants the way they used to be raised, and it's just a little bit more gentle on the planets. If anybody wants to learn something from us, I don't think we've ever said, sorry, we're too busy. We try to find ways to get that learning out there.
Yeah.
People encouraged us all along the way, and so I think it's our turn to also encourage other people along their way too.
When I think back on how far I've come, and I think about how much better the land is and the farm management in general, it's really been a tremendous journey. I feel like it's a gift that I can give the future generations to be able to have this land be better than the state that it came to me in. And that's what we've done over the years. I've seen tremendous improvements in the land, the grasses, and in the animals. But I'm proud of being a farmer, being a rancher. I'm proud of what I've accomplished, and I'm really looking forward to seeing how much more I can do in the future.
There's a very high price for innovation, as I said earlier, in that innovation is a very messy process. There are many dead ends. There are many mistakes. There are many systems that you have to dial in. And there are many variables in a natural system that can all go awry on you and unravel in a heartbeat. The fact is, if you want to finish cattle in a feedlot, you can do it any time of the year and you run up and down the bunk with a truck. That's easy. But having a quality steak every week for 52 weeks a year, regardless of what the environment is doing, that's not so easy. But it can be done, and we're proving it. I wouldn't put myself on much of a pedestal. I've put a lot of effort into what I'm doing. I'm a long ways down the road, but I'm not that far ahead of anyone else. You can be there too. And I think that would be the message for other people, is that don't be afraid. Don't have fear. Don't let that limit you. You can do it, and we can help.
A holistic approach to grazing has changed the lives and livelihoods of ranchers and land managers. But this did not occur using conventional methods and decision making. It required metanoia, a shift in thinking. In addition, each person's journey was based on their own unique holistic goal, and the results varied with what they were trying to achieve, their environment, and the tools they chose to implement. One thing is certain, though. A holistic approach to grazing management is making a difference on the land and in the lives of many practitioners.
There's kind of a part of it all that is so, it's like a magic.